So topic for this video lecture is conservation of mechanical energy, COME, and this forms a part of a bigger topic or bigger chapter of work energy and power. So suppose a stone of mass M is projected vertically up with the speed V such that it reaches a maximum height of H. Of course, H will be equal to V square by 2G. We are ignoring air resistance, or we can consider the stone to be thrown in vacuum so that there is no resistance, or there, in case of vacuum, no air molecules. So this is a common thing, and we know after reaching the maximum height, it starts falling back and it comes back to A with the same speed. So let's say if we mark 5 points, each at a distance of H by 4, H by 4, H by 4 and H by 4. And if we calculate speed at each point and calculate kinetic energy using 1 by 2 mv square. So if the lowest point kinetic energy is k, here it will become 3 by 4 k, half k, 1 by 4 k and 0. So every quarter distance, quarter of the kinetic energy is getting lost. So kinetic energy, it keeps going up, is being lost in a linear fashion. So gradually it reduces to zero and reaches the top. So here, whatever kinetic energy had, when it reaches the top, it has zero kinetic energy. But on its downward journey, it regains whatever kinetic energy it had lost. So when it again after reaching E, when it comes back to D, it will have 1/4 of the initial kinetic energy, and similarly all other points, it will have the same kinetic energy as it had on this upward motion. And when it reaches A, it regains entire kinetic energy K. The direction will be opposite, but kinetic energy will be same. What does it indicate? It indicates that the kinetic energy which appeared to have been lost was stored in some recoverable form of energy. So if we change in kinetic energy, what is lost was stored somewhere, and we call that other form of energy where it was temporarily stored as potential energy. So change in kinetic energy was equal to negative of change in potential energy. When this decreases, this increases. When this decreases, this increases. But we also know that change in kinetic energy is also equal to, in this case, only one force is acting, which is gravitational force. So change in kinetic energy is equal to work done. So indirectly, this itself gives me definition of potential energy. What is potential energy? If you take the negative sign here, the change in potential energy is the negative of work done by gravity. Keep this in mind. Change in potential energy is equal to negative of work done by gravity. And what is potential energy? Another form of energy which can be recovered. Another thing what we notice, so what will be the work done by gravity in the round trip? Round trip is what? It comes back to the same point from where it has started. The work done by in round trip by gravity is zero. If we have a similar experiment with a spring. So if you have a block M moving at the speed V on a smooth horizontal surface, it strikes a spring. As it compresses the spring, it keeps losing kinetic energy till it comes to a momentary stop. When it comes to momentary stop, it means entire kinetic energy is lost. Afterwards, after it comes to momentary stop, we'll find the spring will start pushing it back. And spring will start expanding and block will start gaining speed and kinetic energy. When it reaches the original point here, which means when it completes the round trip, we'll find its kinetic energy is same as it was in the original case. The speed remains same, velocity changes direction. So again, the work done in the round trip by spring is zero because the change in kinetic energy is zero. So by work energy theorem, work done by the spring is zero. So this was the second observation. But in place of, suppose the spring was not there and this surface was rough. What will happen if this block is, if we slide a block of mass M with velocity V on a rough surface? Here also, it will gradually lose its kinetic energy and will come to a stop. But unlike previous two cases, it will not return back to its original position. So it will not regain its kinetic energy. So in three cases, first case, work was done by gravitational force. Second case, work was done by spring force. And third case, work was done by friction force. We find first two were similar and they were different from frictional force. So gravity and spring are different from friction. In case of gravity and spring, work done in round trip is zero, whereas in case of friction, it is not zero. So in these two cases, energy was stored in some other form. Here energy was not stored, energy was lost. And these two kind of forces are given a different name. They are called conservative force, and this is called non-conservative force. So what is conservative force in terms of definition? Work done is independent of path, or work done in a closed loop is equal to zero, as was the case in case of gravity and spring force. Another way you can say is, when object moves under conservative forces only, then there's no loss of energy to the surrounding. Energy transfer doesn't take place to surrounding. It is retained in the object itself. And so there's a term, we have briefly discussed potential energy. So when the forces acting are conservative, then only there's an associated potential energy. So potential energy is defined only for conservative forces. And what is change in potential energy is a negative of work done by conservative force. So how to calculate change in potential energy? Change in potential energy is as simple as calculation of work done. So if we are comfortable with the concept of calculation of work done, calculation of change in potential energy should be quite simple. So how do we express change in potential energy? We use the term U to indicate potential energy. So du will be the change in potential energy. That will be equal to negative of work done by conservative force. What does Fc indicate? Conservative force. So it's a dot product between force and displacement, which is work done by conservative force. For larger displacement, we can add up all this work done through the process of integration. So that becomes my change in potential energy when the displacement takes from initial position Ri to final position Rf. This is the most general form. We consider displacement to be, it may have component in all three directions, and force also could be variable. For a simpler case or subset of this, if the force is constant, exactly what we have seen in case of work done, if you are not comfortable, go through the concept of work done again. If force is constant, what will happen? If force is constant, this term can be taken out of the integration sign. So it becomes minus fc dot summation of all small displacement. And summation of all small displacement vector is nothing but resultant displacement, Rf minus Ri or delta R. So in case of constant force, there's no need for integration. Using this dot product between conservative force and the displacement vector, we can find out change in potential energy. It is independent of the path anyway. And in case of one dimensional motion, if the displacement takes place only in x direction, in that case, we can take the x component of the conservative force into dx. This both are in magnitude form. So there is no dot product here. So for larger displacement, it would be integration of x component of conservative force into dx and limits of integration from initial x coordinate to final x coordinate. And we will use the same thing in case of a spring. So this is for variable force, this is for constant force, and this is the general form. So depending on the nature of the force, we can use one of the three to find out change in potential energy. So let's start with first part. So in first year syllabus, we'll deal with only two types of potential energy or two types of conservative forces. One is gravitational force, other is elastic or spring force. There's also electrical forces which we'll deal in the second year. So for now, we'll confine ourselves only to two forms of potential energy. Gravitation first, and then we'll deal with spring potential energy. And finally, we'll take few cases where both form of energies are involved together. We'll start with gravitational potential energy. So gravitational potential energy changes with the change in distance from the Earth center, or more simple form, we can take it in terms of height. Height is nothing but a displacement in a direction perpendicular to horizontal surface, or displacement along the radial vector of the Earth. So if an object is moved from point A to B, its coordinates are x1, y1, or position vector of A is x1 I cap plus y1 j cap. I cap along horizontal direction, j cap vertically upward direction. So what will be change in potential energy between A and B as it moves from A to B? B is the final point, A is the initial point. So this is constant force. We use the constant force formula minus dot product of conservative force and displacement. So displacement is RB minus RA. We substitute these values. We find the change in potential energy UB minus UA is equal to MG into Y2 minus Y1. What we find, X1 and X2 will not matter at all. So displacement along the horizontal direction does not change potential energy, which we have seen in case of work done also. It only depends on displacement in or vertical component of displacement. This term will be positive if Y2 is greater than Y1. So what is Y2 minus Y1? Y2 minus Y1 is H. So potential energy will increase by MGH as we go up by a height H by any path. So from this line, if we move to this line, if we move a mass M from this line through any path, it could be a parabolic path, it can go up and come down also, it could be any path we choose which connects this line to this line or this horizontal plane to this horizontal plane, the potential energy will increase by MGH. And if we go vertically down and by a vertical displacement of H, then it will decrease by MGH. So change in position along x-axis or motion in horizontal plane does not change the potential energy. The reason being, no work is done by gravitational force when displacement is perpendicular to direction of gravitational force. Hence, potential energy remains constant. So far we have dealt with change in potential energy. What is potential energy? Potential energy, for calculation of potential energy, we need to choose a reference or initial point having zero potential energy. So suppose we assume potential energy on x-axis to be zero. So here potential energy at x-axis is zero. In that case, the potential energy of A will be equal to mg into y1, and potential energy of mass M at B will be equal to mg into y2. So potential energy depends on mass as well as its height from the reference level. What is reference level? Reference level is the horizontal surface at which potential energy is assumed to be zero. In case of a spring, the potential energy changes when the free end of the spring undergoes displacement. How do we calculate potential energy? This is a case of variable force. So and displacement is, we assume x direction along the direction of the spring. So displacement is only in one direction, which is x direction. So change in potential energy is equal to fx into dx. We are not using any dot product, but both are in the same direction. So if we substitute the values, we can find fx equal to, we substitute the values, we find change in potential energy is equal to, this is the term for change in potential energy. Again, if we choose a reference point, what is the reference point? If we assume the initial point at equilibrium and we assign a potential energy of zero at position of equilibrium, so basically xi is zero and potential energy at x equal to zero, potential energy at x equal to zero, in that case potential energy at displacement of x is equal to 1/2 kx². So this is the relationship between potential energy and displacement. X is the displacement from the position of equilibrium, and at state of equilibrium potential energy is zero. So we can plot this one. What is the shape? This shape, clearly, if we plot this on the y-axis and this on the x-axis, it is an equation of a parabola. So this is the shape of potential energy in case of spring. So at mean position, potential energy is zero, and in case of positive or negative, if the displacement is same, the potential energy is same. It does not matter which direction it is. If magnitude or displacement are same, whether it's an extension of the spring or compression of the spring, potential energy is same. So potential energy of ideal spring is a parabolic function of displacement x from equilibrium. So before we go to conservation of mechanical energy, we'll begin with work energy theorem. What is work energy theorem? Sum of work done by all forces is equal to change in kinetic energy. That's work energy theorem. Now what we have done in this part of video lecture, we have bifurcated forces into two categories, conservative and non-conservative. So we work done also we divide into two categories. So if both forces are acting and both forces are doing work, this is work done by conservative forces, this is work done by non-conservative forces is equal to change in kinetic energy. But work done by conservative forces is equal to minus delta U. So we take minus delta U to this side becomes plus delta U. So this equation for when we bifurcate into two types of forces, work done by non-conservative forces is equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. This becomes modified form of work energy theorem. So let's look at, in this case, we do not differentiate between conservative and non-conservative forces. All forces are treated in a similar fashion. So there's no concept, we don't use concept of potential energy here. But in case of modified form of work energy theorem, we first identify which are the conservative forces, which are non-conservative forces. So if we calculate work done by non-conservative force, that will be equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. Or other way I can tell one, what is sum of these two? Change in mechanical energy. So work done by non-conservative force is equal to change in mechanical energy. So if work done by non-conservative force is positive, mechanical energy will increase. If work done by non-conservative forces negative, mechanical energy of the system will decrease. This modified work energy theorem. It involves both kind of work done by both types of forces. If work done by non-conservative forces zero, in that case, change in mechanical energy is zero or mechanical energy is constant. So initial mechanical energy is equal to final mechanical energy. And this relationship or this condition is called conservation of mechanical energy. When is in which case it is applicable? Mechanical energy is constant if forces doing work on the system are conservative. Or other way we are saying, if work done by non-conservative forces are zero. So two cases, work done by non-conservative forces will be zero. Either non-conservative forces are absent, there is no non-conservative force acting on the particle or system. Or second case could be, though there are non-conservative forces, but displacement is perpendicular to non-conservative force. So work done by non-conservative force is zero. So this is the third category. This is, so again, let's look at, so there are three similar cases. All cases relate work done and kinetic energy. First case, work done by all forces. Here we calculate work done by non-conservative forces. In case of conservative force, we take change in potential energy. And third case, mechanical energy conservation, is we use only when work done by non-conservative forces zero. We can equate initial mechanical energy to final mechanical energy. So three options. Though they are very similar, but depending on the case, we can use one of these three. So let's start with simple example. If there's a uniform rod of mass M and length L is standing vertically on a smooth horizontal surface. So somehow we have balanced the rod, it is standing in a vertical state. Find its potential energy, assuming the surface as reference. So at the ground surface, at this point, at this level, or at this horizontal surface, we assume potential energy to be zero. So far what we have learned? We have learned if a point mass M is at a height of h from the reference level, its potential energy is mgh. Height must be constant, but here different parts of the rod are at different height. How do we calculate potential energy of rod or such system? If we take an infinitely small piece of rod, it will be like a point mass or particle, and we can calculate potential energy for that small piece. So conceptually, we divide the rod into infinite number of small pieces. We calculate potential energy of one piece and add up for all pieces through process of integration. We'll pick up a random piece. What is random piece? Mass is dm at a height of h and length of this piece is dh. We'll calculate its potential energy in terms of h and integrate for h varying from 0 to l. This method will follow to calculate its potential energy. So simple process. So what is du? Dm, mass is dm into g into h. What is mass of this small length? Total mass divided by l into length of this piece m by l into dh. So integrate from h is equal to 0 to l, we'll find the potential energy will come equal to mg into l by 2. So what does mg by l by 2 indicate? It indicates it is equivalent to mass, entire mass of rod being placed at its midpoint. So whenever this uniform was, we can assume that entire mass is placed at its midpoint. Now, if the surface is smooth, if the rod falls, what will its kinetic energy just when the top end is about to hit the floor? See, when it starts falling, what will happen? This potential energy will start decreasing, kinetic energy will start increasing. So when it is almost flat, its potential energy will zero and entire potential energy will be in form of kinetic energy. So when rod is top end of the rod is about to hit the ground, its kinetic energy will be equal to its initial potential energy, which is equal to mg L by 2. So let's take next problem. So here what we see, there's a small block is released from A. So this is from A to B is a smooth track. It's like a perfect water slide. There's no friction at all from A to B. In the case of normal slide, there's some friction. Here it's ideal scenario, no friction at all. But the horizontal part of the track from B onwards is rough. From here, it is rough surface and coefficient of friction given as mu. So find the distance traveled on the horizontal track before coming to stop. So this block of mass m, a small block mass is not given, let the mass be m, is released from A. So if we visualize what kind of motion it will have, as it starts sliding down, it will pick up its speed, it will keep gaining kinetic energy, keep losing potential energy, and at this point its speed will be maximum. But moment enters the rough patch here, the friction force will start acting against its motion. It will suffer retardation and finally come to stop. Let's say it travels a distance x on the horizontal surface before coming to stop, and c is the final position of rest. We need to find the distance traveled on the horizontal track before coming to stop. So what does this question involve? This question involves motion and work done. So whenever such questions are there, all questions will involve application of one of the three principles, either work energy theorem, modified form of work energy theorem, or conservation of mechanical energy. So we know, is conservation of mechanical energy applicable here between A and C? No, because friction is acting. The moment we find friction is acting or there is external force acting, conservation of mechanical energy will not apply. So in this particular case, modified form of work energy is applicable. Let's see why. So first, every such question, moment we see it has this kind of motion where kinetic energy and work done by forces are involved, we identify the forces first. What are the forces acting? Normal force, gravity and friction. But out of these three forces, which forces are doing work? Normal reaction is not doing any work. Why it is not doing any work? Displacement is always perpendicular to normal force. Hence, work done by normal force is zero. The forces doing work are only gravity and friction. One of them is conservative, one of them is non-conservative. Hence, which form we have to use? We have to use modified work energy theorem, which is work done by non-conservative forces is equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. Which form of potential energy here? Gravitational potential energy. So whenever we apply change, means there has to be some initial state and there has to be some final state. We need to identify two states. What is state A? Initial state, when the block is just released at point A. Just released means its velocity is still close to zero, and final state is C when it has come to a stop. And since this involves gravitational potential energy, I need to choose a particular level as my zero potential energy level reference. So this is my reference level. The horizontal surface here is my reference level, where the potential energy is zero. Let's apply modified work energy theorem. So what is work done by friction force? Work done by friction forces, how do we calculate? Simple work done calculation is equal to force into displacement into cos of theta. Magnitude of friction force is mu mg, horizontal surface. Mu mg is the friction force. Displacement is x. This part friction force will not do any work. So only in this part friction force will do work. And angle between them, friction force will act in the leftward direction, kinetic friction, and displacement in the rightward direction. So cos theta is minus 1. Hence, minus mu mg x is the work done by friction force, non-conservative force. And that will be change means final mechanical energy minus initial mechanical energy. So mechanical energy at C minus mechanical energy at A. We substitute the values, quite simple. Potential energy at A will be equal to mgs. We substitute these values, we find x is equal to h by mu. So a similar kind of slide. So a particle slides on a smooth track terminating in horizontal section. So this part of the section, this part of the track is horizontal. A particle starts from rest, means at this point the kinetic energy is zero. How far from the track will the particle hit the ground? So quite clearly we can visualize this motion. It will start sliding down, pick up the speed. So this is the lowest point, lowest potential energy, highest kinetic energy. As it starts doing well, it will slow down. It reaches this point. Since the motion is always tangential to the surface, surface is horizontal. Hence, at this point B, velocity also will be horizontal. As soon as it, where the track ends, the normal reaction will stop acting. So only force acting from this point onwards will be gravitational force. Hence, from here onwards, it will have a projectile motion. Since the velocity at this point is horizontal, its motion will be that of a horizontal projectile. So conceptually, how do we solve this question? We need to find how far this object will fall from here. And if we recall about horizontal projectile, height is already given. This distance or range will depend on the velocity here. So indirectly, what I need to do, I need to find the velocity at this point, and then I can apply my horizontal projectile range formula. How do you find velocity at this point? By linking these two points. Well, how do we link those two points? By applying some form of work energy, modified work energy, or conservation of mechanical energy. Which one is applicable? Well, let's find out. What forces are acting? Only two forces acting, normal reaction and gravity. Normal reaction is not doing any work. Okay, sorry, before that, so at B, particle will have horizontal velocity V. And after point B, it will be like a horizontal projectile. And we know the range of horizontal projectile is V into root of 2H by G. H is the height. H is already given as 0.5 meter. So only task is to find out V. How do we find out V? Between A and B, only force doing work is gravity, hence E will be constant. We just equate mechanical energy at A and B, and we can find out. Since gravitational force is involved, we need to choose a reference level for gravitational potential energy. This is what we choose as reference, and then we simply substitute the values. So pretty simple. This is mechanical energy at point A, and this is mechanical energy at B. Kinetic energy 0, potential energy at this point at A is equal to mg into height is 1, mg into 1. Kinetic energy 1 by 2 mv square, and this point potential energy is mg into 0.5. Had we taken the reference level here also, the potential energy here would have been mg into 0.5, and here potential energy would have been 0. Answer would have been same. If we substitute these values, we find V is equal to root g. We substitute V in this equation, we find range will come equal to 1 meter. We continue the smooth track, smooth vertical track. Why we continue the smooth vertical track? Because whenever displacement takes place in vertical direction, the gravitational potential energy will change. So we are dealing with all the questions which involve gravitational potential energy. So on a smooth track, a particle is projected from point O close to the ground. So this may not be so clear from the figure, but assume that this O is very close to the ground, so this distance is negligible. What minimum speed of projection so that it may reach top of the first peak? So what it makes sense, if the speed is too small, it will not reach this height. There has to be a particular value of U, initial speed of projection, for this particle to reach this top here. We are assuming that it is like a roller coaster, it will always move along the surface. It will not fall away from the surface. So how do we find what is the minimum speed of projection? Let's say what is speed. Again, so before we start, we need to check which of these three principles will apply. Force doing work here is gravity only, hence E will be constant. So if the particle reaches B, let's assume the speed at point B is V. Energy here and energy here are constant. So at the top, it will have two forms of energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy. Potential energy is constant, which has to be equal to mg into 2h. Only thing which can vary is the speed or the kinetic energy. Higher the speed, higher will be the kinetic energy, hence higher will be the total energy. Since the energy at this point and this point are same, if energy level is higher here, the energy level has to be higher here as well, or the speed has to be higher. This is a basic idea. Let's see how do we turn this basic idea in terms of equation. So basically, before we apply conservation of mechanical energy, I choose a reference level. The ground level is my reference level. So I formulate this equation, 1 by 2 mu square. This is pretty straightforward. And for u to be minimum, if u has to be minimum, the right hand side also has to be minimum. How do we make right hand side minimum? Only thing we can change is v. So this is minimum when the velocity at the top point is minimum, or kinetic energy at b is minimum. In that case, the speed of projection is minimum. So speed of projection is minimum when particle reaches the top with almost zero speed. And we calculate, we find u square is equal to 4gh, or u will be equal to 2 into root gh. That should be the speed of projection for the particle to reach the first peak, height of 2h. What after it reaches point B, what will subsequent motion? Will it reach C as well? So can we visualize what kind of motion it will have? So after reaching this point, it will start sliding down, pick up its speed. Again, it by the time it reaches here, it will have same speed as u. Again, it goes up, speed will decrease, again increase. And from here, as it start climbing, speed will keep decreasing. Will it reach point C? No. If here the speed was zero, it will reach same height. If v is equal to close to zero, it will reach the same height. It will not reach point C. And after reaching point C, this point it will come to momentary rest and again start falling backwards. It will retrace its path, come back here and reach point O. That's the kind of motion it will have. It will go forward and it will again slide back and retrace its path. So will it reach C? No, answer is no. It will not reach C if this velocity is just zero plus, close to zero, but finite value. So we can again look at the second part of question. What has the minimum value of u to reach C? So again, very similar way. What we have done for point B, we will repeat it for point C. It has to reach C with minimum kinetic energy. Then only speed of projection is minimum. What is minimum kinetic energy? Zero. So potential energy here has to be equal to kinetic energy here. That's a condition, minimum value of u to reach point C. So suppose the question sometime they ask, what is the minimum kinetic energy to reach point P? To reach point P, it has to cross point C. So minimum speed required to reach point P is same as the speed of projection required to reach point C. So same answer, what is there for C? Same answer is valid for point P as well. So far we have dealt with gravitational potential energy. Now we come to the spring or elastic potential energy. A block M is moving with speed V on a smooth horizontal surface. It strikes a spring. It loses half of its kinetic energy when the spring is compressed by A. Find the stiffness of the spring K. How do we begin? velocity, conservative forces. First thing we check, what forces are acting. Only force doing work here is spring force, conservative force. Hence, conservation of mechanical energy is applicable. So we have to choose two states to which we apply. That also is pretty obvious. This is my initial state and this is my final state. Final state, one is kinetic energy is half, velocity is V dash, and compression of the spring is A. So simply, now in case of potential energy, I will not use gravitational potential energy because that is constant. We'll use spring potential energy. We simply substitute these values. Only important point here is what is the kinetic energy in the final state. At this point, kinetic energy is 1 by 2 mv square. Here the kinetic energy is, it has lost half the kinetic energy. It means remaining kinetic energy is half the initial kinetic energy. Hence I will substitute final kinetic energy as half of this term, which is 1 by 4 mv square. And we solve this simple equation, we find the value of k. So this is pretty straightforward application of conservation of mechanical energy. Slight variation of the question. Again, similar question is, what will be maximum compression of the spring? So it makes sense, the spring will, as it touches the spring, as it start pressing the spring will start applying a force in the leftward direction. It will slow down the block, ultimately bringing it to a momentary rest. So what is the maximum compression? So until M touches the spring, the speed will not change. So as the block moves from here to here, the spring will remain, the speed will remain the same. Then thereafter, further displacement of M will be equal to compression of the spring. So after it touches the spring, whatever distance the block moves, same would be the compression of the spring. And compression is maximum when the spring speed is zero. So it will keep compressing as long as velocity is positive. Moment velocity becomes zero, compression will come to a stop. So that will be the condition for maximum compression when the speed is zero. So this, how do you solve? Again, I choose conservation mechanical energy, initial position, final initial state, final state. We apply this, we fill up these values, pretty straightforward. Final potential energy will be equal to 1 by 2 kx square. We simplify, x is equal to root of m by k into v. Again, we take another variation of the similar question. Now, so far the surface was smooth, now the surface is rough. So block of mass 1 kg moving with the speed and has numerical values. What is the speed at this? Speed is 5 meter per second when it is at 2.525 meter from the spring. When the face of the block is 2.525 meter from the spring and the spring is in natural length. That time speed is 5 meter per second. Why? Because as it moves, speed will keep on changing. So we have to give speed for a particular position, unlike previous case. So what will be maximum compression of the spring? So it has some similarity with the previous question and some dissimilarity also. So maximum compression, like previous question, will correspond to speed being zero. But difference is there's one extra force F, and which is a non-conservative force, and friction is doing work. Hence we cannot use conservation of mechanical energy. We'll use modified work energy theorem. So this is the initial state and this one is the final state. So let's see how we apply. What is my modified work energy theorem? Work done by friction, non-conservative force, is equal to change in mechanical energy. Final minus initial mechanical energy. What is work done by friction? So magnitude of friction force, which is mu mg, is straightforward. What is the displacement from initial state to final state? The displacement is distance it travels before it touches the spring plus the compression of the spring. So displacement is 2.525 plus x into cos theta. Displacement is rightwards, friction force is leftwards, hence cos theta is minus 1. So this term is minus mu mg 2.525 plus x. That would be equal to initial kinetic energy plus potential energy. So final potential energy plus kinetic energy. In final state, it will only have potential energy 1 by 2 kx square, and initial mechanical energy only in form of kinetic energy. When we substitute these values and solve, we find the x will come equal to 0.4 meter. So it will come to a stop after compressing the spring by 0.4 meter. So this is a typical application of modified form of work energy theorem, because one of the force doing work is non-conservative. Typically that would be either friction force or an external force. We can have an add-on to this question. After it has come to a stop, what would be subsequent motion? Had the surface been smooth, it would have started moving backwards. But here there is a friction present. So what would be subsequent motion after it has come to a momentary rest? So any object which has come to a rest will again move only when there is a net force. So let's find out what force will act after it has come to a stop. Forces acting, spring force. How much will be spring force? Minus kx. K is equal to 10. Compression is 0.4. And spring force will be 4 newton in the leftward direction. So that's a spring force acting in the leftward direction. Had there been no friction, it would have started moving back. But there's a friction here. So what we need to check, this force is trying to move it. Friction will try to oppose the motion. So the block will move only when this force is greater than maximum frictional force. So we need to check what is the maximum frictional force. So we find maximum static friction, F max is equal to mu times mg. And for given value of mu equal to 0.4, it is equal to 4 newton. Hence, the block will stay at rest. So you can have one more question on this. What will happen? The speed is not 5, say it is 5.1 meter per second. Will the compression be same? No, it has more energy, so it will compress it by more. The compression also will go up little higher. If the compression is little more, what will happen to the force here? The spring force will be little more than 4 newton. Maximum friction will remain at 4 newton. So what will happen? It will start moving backwards if the speed is any greater than 5 meter per second. So another way of saying is 5 meter per second is the maximum possible speed of the block at this distance for it to come to a rest after compressing the spring to maximum extent. Anything lesser than this, it will compress by a distance lesser than 0.4 meter. In case friction force will be lesser and the block will not move. So speed less than 5 meter per second, if the speed is sufficient to reach the spring, in that case it will compress the spring and come to a stop. Greater than 5 meter per second, it will again move backwards for some distance. Now we come to a type of question which involve both forms of potential energy, spring as well as gravitation. The question is, as shown in the figure, a mass M is dropped from height h above an unelongated spring. The stiffness is k. So this is small plate here of negligible mass. So if the mass is dropped from height h above the top of the spring, what would be the maximum compression of the spring? We have done one question of maximum compression when the spring was kept on a smooth horizontal surface. This will be slightly different, some similarity and some differences. So let's understand what will happen. Maximum compression will take place when downward displacement ceases or speed is equal to zero. So maximum compression corresponds to condition of momentary rest. Let's assume the maximum compression is x. So this is the maximum compression. Is conservation of mechanical energy applicable? Only two forces doing work, both are conservative, hence conservation of mechanical energy is applicable. All we need to do, we need to define two states. We need to choose a reference level for gravitational potential energy and formulate the equation. Formation equation is pretty straightforward. So two states are also pretty clear. This initial state, when the mass is just released, so at this point velocity is zero. And final state, this is a final state when the block has come to state of rest. Here also, velocity is, speed is zero. Compression is x maximum compression. Let's just substitute the values of mechanical energy. Straightforward, at this point, the height of this point from the reference level is, be careful, it is h plus x. Because this we are choosing a reference level, this. So initial gravitational potential energy, mg into h plus x, this term zero. And final state, no potential energy only. So no gravitational potential energy, only spring potential energy, 1 by 2 kx square. So it will form a quadratic equation in x which can be solved if all the values are given in numerical form. You may try and solve this question for these numerical values and answer will come as x is equal to 0.1 meter. Simple substitution and solution of quadratic equation. Another variation, just imagine if mass m is attached to a vertically hung spring. The spring constant is k at its natural length. So just assume this spring is hanging from the ceiling. We take this mass m. We have to support by our hand or something. So I am supporting by with my hand and gently attach this mass here. So when I attach this mass, is the spring extended? No, the spring is in the normal length. When it is released suddenly, so suddenly I remove my hand from here. In that case, find the maximum extension of the spring. To solve this question, first I need to understand what kind of motion the mass M will have after its release. So let's say, but this is something it has, so it will, as soon as it release, it will, only force acting in the block will be gravitational force downwards. The spring will not apply any force initially because its extension is zero. Hence, net acceleration will be downwards. It will start speeding downwards. But as it has keep having displacement, spring will get elongated and spring will start applying a force in the upward direction, which will keep on increasing. So when the spring force becomes equal to mg, in that case net force will become zero or acceleration will become zero. So will it come to stop when the acceleration is zero? Both forces are equal? No. Acceleration zero doesn't mean coming to a state of rest. Acceleration zero means velocity will remain constant. So if it has some velocity, its velocity will be constant when the acceleration becomes zero. So thereafter what will happen? It will get further extension. As it gets further extension, a spring force will become greater than mg. In that case, net force will become upwards, whereas velocity is downwards. So initially, until both forces become equal, net acceleration is downwards. Afterwards, net acceleration becomes upwards retardation. So first it will have acceleration, then it will have retardation, and retardation will bring it to final state of momentary rest. That's the kind of motion it will have. We'll study this motion in greater detail in case of SHM. So what will happen? This particle will keep oscillating between two extremes corresponding to two positions of momentary rest. So what we have drawn here are these two, in both cases, momentary velocity or instantaneous velocity are zero. Acceleration is not. Otherwise, had the velocity been zero, acceleration also zero, object would have remained at rest. So how do we calculate x? By application of conservation of mechanical energy. Initial state, final state. I simply formulate the equation. Simple enough, and x will be equal to 2mg by k. That's maximum displacement. Just to understand this question a little better, what is the net force on m at the highest point and the lowest point? So at the highest point, what is the forces acting? Only mg, no spring force, because extension of the spring is zero. It is in natural length. How about at the lowest point? Lowest point, gravitational force is mg, and here the displacement is x. So spring force will be equal to k into x. Let's put the value of x here, 2mg by k. The spring force will be equal to 2mg. Downward force of mg, upward force of 2mg. It means net force at the lowest position is mg, but in the upward direction. So at this point, downward acceleration of g, at this point, upward acceleration of g. So both extreme state, magnitude of acceleration is same, and exactly at the midpoint, acceleration will be zero. We'll study this in greater detail in case of SHM motion. Slight variation of the question. Here the spring is not hanging from the ceiling, there's a pulley as well. So question is similar, a block of mass m, is held at rest with string unextended. The block is released suddenly. Find the maximum displacement of the block from the initial position. So again, what will happen in this case? Again, it will, like previous question, it will oscillate between two extreme positions. If the maximum displacement of m is x, the spring also will have an extension of x. Let's understand how. Let's focus on these 5 points. What will happen? as the block has downward displacement. Let us say this shows the final state. Final state, when the this is the state of rest, this is the maximum extension case when the block has again come to rest. We are assuming that entire mass, though it is shown as a bigger block, entire mass is situated at this point only. So this block has moved down by distance x. Midpoint has moved by distance x. So what has happened since it has moved? This part of the string length has increased by x. Hence, this part of the string length has to decrease by x. How it will decrease? This point will move up by x. This point cannot change, but this part of the string length has to be same. It means the length of the spring will get elongated by same magnitude as the downward displacement of block. So this case is exactly same as the previous one. Only thing what has happened, because of the pulley, the direction of force has changed. So again, if we apply conservation of mechanical energy, we'll find x is equal to 2mg by k. Maximum extension 2mg by k. Net force on m at the highest point and the lowest point, again we find it is same. So this brings us to the end of conservation of